Hey, what is up gamers? I can't believe I'm already making the 16th video about my NES game journey. I didn't expect that this journey is going to be that long. By the way, I've created an itch.io page for my game. It's some sort of a platform for indie games. I think it's a much better place to download the game from. Sites like GitHub might be confusing or intimidating if you're not a developer. And this platform is pretty nice. You can add a bunch of screenshots and even write devlogs there. Also, there's a possibility to support me. But of course, if you don't want to, you can still download the game for free. So links are in the description. Feel free to check it out. Okay, now let's talk about what I've been up to during these past weeks. I kinda wanted to expand the cave and make it more interesting. Also, there was this mystery what actually are those so-called werewolves in my game and where they came from. If they are truly werewolves, then there should be a bunch of people during the day. So where are they? Maybe there could be some kind of a portal inside the cave that leads to a werewolf dimension. But then I remembered that I wanted to show in the intro that a laser hits the plane of the main character, and then it clicked. What if those werewolves are not just supernatural monsters or some creatures from a parallel universe, but what if they are actually aliens, like aliens from outer space, but with fur, you know, space furs. I was actually really pumped about this concept and started making a completely new location that can be reached from the cave. So that's gonna be the main place where the werewolves reside. From now on, in order to reach your plane, you will have to not only to cross the cave, but also this so-called alien base. I've noticed that I had an exact same duplicate copy of my main tile set in the Bank 4. I don't know what I was thinking back then, but what if we could use this tile set for the alien base graphics instead? The very first iteration of this alien base wasn't that impressive to look at. I just drew a couple of tiles. I think the base looked way too bright, if you know that it's for the creatures who hide during the day. Later on, I added more tiles, and now you can find at the very end of this base a display where you can see something that resembles our main character. It's creepy, right? Sure, this place doesn't look that alien so far. Maybe it resembles, say, some sort of a science lab. But that's okay. I don't want to, like, explain or give certain names to places. It's for the players to decide what is what. If somebody thinks it's a secret science lab, then it's fine by me. While working on this new location, I had an urge to improve my own map editor. I know it's a kind of a pointless endeavor, but I really wanted to. My editor had a bug that caused loaded CHR tiles to look not quite correct. So I fixed that and added a possibility to use different color palettes. I just simply create 4 different textures from the same CHR during the launch of the editor. Now you can specify a map, a some sort of a palette list, and a tile set in the same ini file, and the map in my editor could look exactly just like in the game. Still, my editor is a mere far cry in terms of functionality compared to screen tool, but who knows, maybe one day I could completely rely on my own editor. Since the werewolves are aliens now, I needed to make the laser beam in the intro, but I couldn't really use the sprites to animate the beam. So I had to code some sort of a background tile animation. Every few frames I change a couple of tiles to create an illusion that the beam is moving. Also, I attached a meta sprite at the end of the beam. It's the same meta sprite that used to be a rocket. It would have been messy to change the palette for the beam on the go, so I also modified the name table with screen tool. If you set incorrect palette colors, you can actually see where this beam will go. I also added a red-yellow blinking animation, as one of my viewers suggested. I think it fits the laser more nicely. I kind of felt that the location where I put the K cave entrance was a bit crammed already. So I decided to move the entrance to a separate screen and make a forest barrier between those screens. While adding one exciting feature after another, I accumulated a huge amount of bugs that I kept untreated. It was time to do something about at least some of them. The most embarrassing bug to me was the way the items were spawned when you used a hammer or a fishing rod. Especially the hammer, since I announced it as a new equipable item. Sure, it worked fine in the very first screen, but if you would go further and try to use it, you would notice that something is off with it. I could have seen that if I would actually spend some time and played my own game. Well, finally I did that, and after some fixing, I think the items will gonna appear where they supposed to. There was also this funny bug where bunnies could escape the map and would run inside the status bar. I think I made the end to that as well. The hammer had another hilarious bug. If you kept hitting the fireplace inside the hut, you would extract some sticks eventually. So technically there would be no need to go outside to gather firewood. It was happening because the indoor map used a different tile set. In the fireplace tiles and tree tiles in the main tile set used the exact same tile indexes. So basically the game thought that you were hitting a tree. So now I disabled the hammer's extraction abilities indoors and also inside the alien base. Because who knows, you might be getting some sticks by hitting that display there. The last annoying bug I fixed used to manifest when you entered the Bjorn's house just before the nightfall. So for some reason, out of sudden, you could not give your items to Bjorn. It was because at that very moment it was already night and Bjorn was supposed to go to sleep, but it wasn't visible to the player. So I fixed that. Now this dude will not go to sleep until you leave his home. Okay, that's enough about bugs. Now let's talk about small improvements that I made to the game. Sometimes it was pretty difficult to pick up items, mainly because you can only pick an item if a point in the center of the main character's base collides with a bounding box of that item. Now I check both the player's and the item's bounding box intersections. Also, the item bounding boxes are a bit bigger. So now it should be easier to gather items, even if those items are spawned inside obstacles. The spear as a weapon was actually a big disappointment. You could easily lose it if you accidentally launch it, let's say, inside the house, or if you miss your target. All that resource gathering and crafting would simply go to waste. Well, not anymore. Now the spear simply collides with the environment, and when the spear projectile hits an obstacle, it disappears. But in that place, a spear item is spawned, so you can pick it up, equip it, and launch it again. But when you actually hit an animal with a spear, the spear item is not spawned. It's because you successfully hit your target and your spear didn't go to waste. It seemed to me that previously it wasn't that obvious why out of sudden you get a game over screen. It seems like everything was fine and then boom, you're dead. I think it was hard to notice that your HP is running out. Not anymore. I made a palette animation that works when you get a damage from cold or hunger. So simply the dark blue color that is used for the background tile outlines is changed to a bright red for a couple of frames. So out of sudden you might get this red blinking now. That means you're slowly dying. Also, I made the same thing with the player character's outline when some NPC is trying to hit our dude. This way it's obvious that you're getting the damage. Also, I've noticed that it's very annoying that your warmth points are restored so slowly. Sure, probably in the real life also you would have to spend more time indoors after being in freezing cold. But the fact is, it's just a game. And games supposed to be fun. It's not very fun to wait. So I made this separate speed for the warmth recovery. And it should be much faster now. The granny villager that I added recently was somewhat pointless there, so I wanted to create a connection between her and other villagers. For that, I created a new type of quests. So it will basically let you to bring an item from one villager to another. In this case, we will have to deliver a pie from the hedgehog lady to the granny. So yeah, I added a new item, a pie. If you accidentally eat it, you can craft it again by combining cooked meat and some berries. I placed this new quest as the third quest for the hedgehog lady. The granny would give you some jam as a reward for the delivered pie, but also you would get additional reward from the hedgehog lady. And that's all the changes for now. If you're interested what other stuff I will add to my game, then make sure you subscribe my channel. So that's it. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Bye.